Welcome back to part two of this tutorial on Resolve to Adobe Premiere Proxy Workflow. If you're not sure where we are, check out the previous videos in this playlist. Also, feel free to check out the description box below for chapter markers and jump to the sections you need. The next thing that we're going to do is we're going to apply a temporary LUT to this footage. So as you can see, it's looking pretty washed out. It was probably shot in some sort of log C. I know this was an Aeroflex camera, so I think it was a mini. Anyway, we want to make it look a little bit richer. And this is just going to be our template for offline editing, just so that it looks sort of decent. This is not going to be the final color correct. The final color correct will happen way down the line later when we've locked our edit. So what we can do here in Resolve is we can very easily apply a simple LUT to all of the clips at once, or we can go through clip by clip. Now, I know from this project, from my notes from set, that they have a few LUTs that they had planned. And actually, I can see... on each slate, because they were very good about this, they put the LUT that they wanted me to use here on the slate. And they provided those LUTs to me with the footage. So I'm going to go ahead and apply those LUTs to this footage. So what we're going to do is we're going to select all the clips in the bin. We're going to right click and we're going to go to this LUT menu right here. And so as you can see, there are a whole bunch of preset LUTs that are already included with Resolve. So if you didn't get a LUT from set, you don't really have any information, what you can do is you can look through and you could pick a different LUT based on the camera that you were shooting at. For example, there are a bunch of Arri LUTs. There's an Arri Alexa Log C to Rec 709, which like looks pretty good. So if I didn't have my LUTs from set, I would probably pick that one, because I know that this is shot in Arri RAW. But I do have LUTs from set, so what I want to do is I want to load them so that they appear in this menu. They currently don't appear in the menu. So I'm going to turn the LUT off, and I'm going to show you how to do that. So we go into the settings, and then we're going to go to the color management section of the settings. These are the general project settings. And we'll go down to lookup tables, and we're going to open our LUT folder. So this is going to point us to where all of the LUTs live. For Resolve, and we can move any LUTs we want into this folder. So I'm going to create a new subfolder, and I'm going to call it HMS LUTs, so that shows up right at the top. And then I'm going to navigate to the hard drive where they gave me the LUTs, and I'm just going to drag and drop those LUTs into this folder. So they've given me three different LUTs. I'm just going to drag them in. Okay, and then I'm going to go back into Resolve, and I'm going to update the lists. And save. And now when I pop into the LUT menu, it should show my LUTs here, and I can pick which one. So I know for these ones, for this scene, that it's going to be all the same LUT because they told me that, but you can go through your notes and you should apply whatever LUT you think or know to be the best option for this. So I'm going to apply the Teo Maya LUT. So it looks kind of similar to the Arri RAW, but this is like a little bit darker and it's just colored a little bit differently. And these were decisions that were made on set by the DOP and the DIT. So we're going to use that. I'm also going to add that LUT information to the comments field. So I'm just going to write that that was the LUT that was applied and save that. So if anyone's wondering when they're doing their offline edit, they can see what LUT was applied. And if an incorrect LUT was applied, then they can request that it be fixed. By the way, if you like this content, don't forget to like and subscribe to the channel and let me know in the comments what other content you might like to see. Okay, the next thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to create an output timeline. And usually the way that I do this is I make one timeline per bin. And each bin in this case has a camera roll in it. And so the function of this is that it keeps the output timelines relatively short and allows me to more easily troubleshoot them. So if in the process of doing an output, something crashes or fails, I'm not trying to go through and troubleshoot 45 minutes or 3 hours worth of clips. I'm just going through like, you know, 10 or 15 minutes worth of stuff. So I'm going to select all of the clips here and I'm going to create a new timeline using the selective clips. I'm going to name the timeline the same name as the camera reel, just because I feel like that's pretty organized. And I am going to uncheck use selected mark in or out because we want to make sure that each full clip appears on the timeline. I'm going to check use project settings. Just if I uncheck that, it will offer me the option to change the timeline resolution and that sort of thing. But I already set up my project the way that I wanted at the beginning. So if I click Use Project Settings here, I know that I'm going to get the settings that I want in my timeline. And I'm going to click Create. And now it's made a little timeline for me here that has all of the clips on it. It's just strung them all out in order, right? And this timeline is just over about 12 minutes long. It's very manageable in length. It's easy to scrub through, and it will be very quick to export as well. Now, one thing that I notice about this footage in particular, and I would encourage everyone to always check this, is I notice that the sizing of the frame is not really conducive to what I want in my edit. So they shot, in this particular production, they shot 3424 by 2202, which is a 1:55 to 1 aspect ratio. It's part of the anamorphic setups of the RE Alexa Mini that they were shooting. But I know for a fact that we're not going to be editing or finishing with this full frame size. As you can see, it's like super distorted on the edges. And the intention is that we're going to crop into this a little bit closer. So I know that I'm actually going to be editing and we're going to be finishing in the aspect ratio of 2:39:1. And I know that because I've talked to my director and my DOP about it. If you're not sure, you should absolutely ask people what your finishing aspect ratio and resolution is going to be before you process your dailies. So I need to get this 1:55:1 into a 2:39:1 size so that when I export it, it's a proper frame size for my offline edit. And I'm going to do that just by actually using the resize function. So when I open up the inspector, I'm going to use the zoom function to zoom in and out. But I don't really know by eye how much to zoom. So I'm going to show you guys what I normally do. You may have known about this website. It's editingtools.io. This is not sponsored. It's just like a super handy website that I use all the time. They have a bunch of different generators and converters. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to generate a letterbox. And so my offline resolution is 1920 by 1080 HD. I know that my letterbox is going to be 2:39:1 because that's what we had discussed. There you are, theatrical and Blu-ray. And rather than make the color of the letterbox black, which you could choose if you wanted, I'm going to make it white and I'll show you why in a second. And I'm going to click generate. So here it's generated for me this lovely little PNG, it's going to be a PNG file, a little mask that I can use. So I'm going to download that and I'm going to bring that into Resolve. And I'm literally going to throw it on top of some of my footage here. And we're just using it, we're not going to leave it there permanently, we're just using it as a reference. So we can see here the difference between the 2:39:1 mat and the size of the current footage. So I'm just going to zoom in to a point where we're pretty matched. And it looks like 1.3 is pretty close. There's a little bit of a line there, so 1.31. Okay, so I can see that my zoom percentage is about 1.31, and that's going to give all of these clips a proper size. So now I don't need this mat anymore. I'm going to get rid of it and I'm going to copy. I'm just going to hit Apple C or Command C to copy from that clip. I'm going to select all, right click, paste attributes, and I'm going to paste. I mean, I can paste everything because the only thing I've changed is the sizing, and I'm going to click apply. So now I have the correct sizing on all of these clips. Now, if I want, I don't have to do that. If I want to, I could export the clips with the full width, but because I know what the sizing is, I think this is just going to make everyone's life easier. They don't have to constantly be applying resizes in Premiere because that just causes the whole thing to slow down. Okay. The next step that I am going to do here is I'm going to add a data burn-in to this footage. And the reason for doing that is just because it's really, really helpful when you're cutting an offline edit to be able to have a visual reference of the source file name and the time code. It's also really handy in case something goes wrong, in case metadata gets lost somehow. You would be surprised at how often people actually reference the visual time code on these things. Okay, and we're going to add the data burn-in by going to Workspace, Data Burn-in. And here's where you can choose whether you want to apply the data burn-in to the whole project or just the clip. In this case, I'm picking the whole project. And the important data that I want to show on screen that I usually always choose is the source time code, the source clip name and the real name. And sometimes it doesn't show up, and then you got to wiggle it, and then it shows up. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to change this to like a nice small size so that it's really unobtrusive. And I'm going to stick everything down kind of at the bottom of the screen. Okay, so now I've got my data burn in. It's still easy to read, but it's relatively unobtrusive. Having it down under the letterbox is really handy. If you don't have a letterbox on your footage, you can, for example, if your footage makes it look more like it's here, you can always just turn the background opacity down. You can even turn the text opacity down to make it like very unobtrusive. So you can pick the layout and settings that you want. And then you can even save this as a preset if you like. Up here, you can make a new preset, which I enjoy presets. So we're pretty much ready to go with this. And I am going to take the next step, which is delivering the timeline. So we're going to deliver the timeline in two ways. We're going to deliver the actual media from the timeline, which we're going to use the deliver window to create proxy media. And then we're going to go back and we're going to deliver the metadata from the timeline by creating a metadata file. So I'm going to start with the actual media first, and I'm going to create the proxies for Premiere. So here we have the timeline. It's pretty much ready to be delivered. And so we're going to go up here and have a look at the delivery settings, and we are going to set up a Premiere friendly export. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to ask it to render individual clips. This means it's going to render each clip as its own file. It's not going to just render the whole timeline out as one fat clip, because that's not going to be useful to us at all. The Premiere friendly format that we're going to pick is QuickTime, and we're going to pick Apple ProRes 422 proxy. The proxy is usually more than good enough to like send cuts over Vimeo or the ways that most of us are trading cuts nowadays. If you want to be fancier, you could choose LT, but just obviously be aware that it takes more processing power and more space. By the way, don't under any circumstances try to edit with H.264 or MP4 files. It's just a disaster. It's going to cause so much pain on your system, and it's not going to be fun, and you're going to hate yourself. So just make sure you stick with something that's editing friendly, like Apple ProRes. We're going to render at a 1920 by 1080 HD resolution because we want our dailies to be that size. And under the advanced settings, the only thing you really need to check is to make sure that the data burn-in says same as project, because you've now created this lovely data burn-in that you want. And if you change your mind, you can always turn it off and say none, but just make sure it says same as project so it will show up the way that you want. Under audio, in my case, I'm not exporting any audio because there isn't any audio on these clips. But if you have camera audio that you need because you're doing like waveform syncing in Premiere, or maybe your final audio was run straight to camera, and you just want to make sure that it stays attached to your files, then you would turn on the export audio. You would export as linear PCM. You would do same as source number of channels, and you would probably do a 24-bit depth. So that would be your kind of standard audio setting if you were exporting audio. But I'm going to turn that off because I don't need it. And then under the file name, we're going to use the source name. So it's going to create a file that has the same name as the original source file. And that's pretty much it. And so those are all the settings. We're going to make sure that it says here, render entire timeline and not into out range. That way, if we've accidentally set ins to outs, we're not going to be exporting partial pieces. Okay, so it's pretty much ready to go. I am going to, I got to pick my save location. I'm going to create a folder here called Premiere Dailies inside my project folder. And I'm also going to be, you know, this is just a demo, but ideally you would create a subfolder based on like the timeline name or the real name or something like that. So you're exporting each timeline into its own subfolder. Again, this is just really helpful for troubleshooting if anything goes wrong or wonky. And click open. And then I'm going to add that to the render queue, and it's ready to go. Now, I could like render it now and then come back, but I'm going to render it in a sec because I'm going to do the second part of the export, which is the metadata export. And I'm going to show you how to do that. And this is like the really key way that you can get a lot of your more specific metadata, including like the description and the comments field and stuff, into Adobe Premiere. So I'm going to go back to the edit section, and I'm going to make sure that my timeline is open. So this only works if the timeline is open. If you just select it in the media pool, you're not going to have the same options on this pop-up menu, which is I've right-clicked it, I'm going to timelines, and I'm going to export, and I'm going to export the ALE. So ALE is a metadata file format, works with Avid Media Composer, also works with Premiere. A lot of people don't know this, but it works with Premiere. And it's a really easy way to get a whole bunch of metadata across. And it's because it has good interoperability with different edit systems, it's the one that I always choose. So I'm going to click ALE here, and then it's going to ask me where I want to save it. And as an organizational process, I actually like to save the ALEs in the same folder that I'm going to save the media, just because that way I can know that I can always find it. And I'm going to click Save. And so it says it's exported the ALE successfully. So now I'm going to click OK. I'm going to go back to the deliver window. I have my job ready to go that I've already queued up. So now I'm going to render this, and I'm just going to go hang out for a little while it renders. And then I'm going to come back, and we're going to open all this stuff up in Premiere, and I'll show you how to take the next steps. This tutorial is continued in the next video. If you have questions, you can pop them in the comments, and I'll do my best to answer. Thanks for watching.